Hey guys, SJ Newell here. So I finally did it. After multiple recommendations and requests, I finally started watching American Gospel. A few preliminary thoughts. This is by far the longest video I've ever dealt with, so obviously I had to adjust my usual format. I can't play the entire movie, so I mainly had to skip the portions that I agreed with. But I do want to say up front, I agreed with a lot in this movie, at least the parts I've seen so far. I haven't finished watching it. But especially the first 40 minutes from the free version that dealt with understanding the gospel. I enjoyed it so much, in fact, that I actually made my entire family sit down and watch it with me. But it's difficult doing critiques this way because you always risk cutting the video mid-thought and taking what's being said out of context. At the same time, you have to balance the fact that you can't show the whole video. So I want to say up front, I know I'm entirely capable of taking something out of context. If I did it, I didn't mean to, and anyone is free to correct me, and I'll put any corrections in the comments. I'm still not sure I'm going to critique the whole movie. I thought I'd do this first one, and you guys can let me know if you'd like me to cover the rest in future videos. One more thing, we reached out to American Gospel to help ensure there were no misunderstandings. Brandon Kimber was kind enough to issue a few responses. So this will be my critique, Kimber's Notes Edition.
I was raised as a very devout Muslim in the United States. And the fact of the matter was, every time I connected with the Christian, I realized that they didn't know why they believed what they believed.
The Christians who were around me wouldn't share the gospel with me, and I never realized why. I concluded either they didn't believe the gospel was true, or if they did believe it, they didn't care if I went to hell.
It is a pain to know that there are people who do not know Jesus. It is a greater pain to know that oftentimes Jesus and Christianity is being distorted.
Quick pause here. So I'm already seeing with the music and different cutaway scenes that there is a potential for emotional appeal. Obviously, getting worked up by dramatic wording and imagery and music isn't always conducive to trying to evaluate a topic fairly.
So it turns out this guy has a son. Son's a doctor too. They'd had some kind of big time falling out. The guy knew it was his fault.
I was emotional throughout the entire series of Lost. I felt especially bad for misty-eyed Jack and his relationship with his father. But guess what? It was all fake.
Something tells me he never got around to making that call.
If you're not paying attention, these types of presentations can creep by your intellect, speak right to the old feelings, and then your feelings will tell your intellect that you need to figure out a way to justify how you feel, because gosh darn it, this just has got to be true. So let's just keep our wits about us moving forward here.
Who told you you can't accomplish your dreams?
I think around the world, they know the phrase, the American dream.
Your destiny is calling out. It's time to start living large.
We are exporting the very worst of what Christianity has to offer.
Okay, so no real substance provided for this claim here, that we are exporting the very worst that Christianity has to offer. I mean, the very worst? Really? So we did check with Kimber on this statement, and he says that DeMar is using hyperbole here. You'll find a common theme of inflammatory language in a lot of criticisms Christians use on one another. Something you disagree with isn't just wrong, it's the very worst. Or like from our recent Costi Hinn rebuttal, if we think someone is lying, they're not just lying, they're a dangerous deceiver. I'm going to link to some videos where we go into more depth about this kind of mindset. All it takes is a little creativity and maybe a thesaurus if you really want to spice things up with extra adjectives. But as far as actual scripture goes, I wouldn't even know where to begin to try to justify this claim made by DeMar. According to Kimber, it's just an open thesis statement, so we'll leave it at that.
I declare you debt-free today, saith God.
So that many people harden their heart against a Jesus, a Christ, a Christianity, that is not the true version of it.
It's as easy to get healed as it is to get forgiven.
Okay, a few clips from ministers like Copeland and Hinn are being mixed in here. I don't know if they are going to unpack these further in the film, or if they're just being compiled without context to further a narrative by the makers of the film. Either way, only time will tell, and if need be, maybe I'll go back afterwards and address them.
Here's what you'll keep infusing yourself into the stories of the Bible like you're the hero.
And so a way of reading the Bible that always makes man the hero and not the acts of God the hero. I think if you mess that up, then you're reading the Bible entirely wrong. Because the Bible wants to consistently get your eyes off of you and onto a God who is able. So it's not you that are able, it's God that's able. And so I think David and Goliath, you're right, it's just a perfect story for it. That anytime you hear the David and Goliath story, you're hearing about how you're David.
In order for David to become David, he needed Saul. Stop despising Saul. You need Saul. You need people to hate on you. You need the people to tear you up. Thank God for Saul, because if you got a Saul, that makes you David.
I want to be straight. I love you enough to be straight. You're not David.
Okay, keep in mind, David wrote most of the Psalms from a first-person perspective, and teachers and believers have been using those passages for thousands of years to reflect on their own relationships with God. In fact, one of the most common scriptures used for man's depravity is when David said he was conceived in iniquity. But okay, let's say we're not David. Here are a few things that you, the believer, are in Christ. You are a new creation. You're a masterpiece. You're the righteousness of God in Christ. You're redeemed. You're able to partake of the divine nature. You're forgiven. You're able to perform the miraculous deeds that Jesus did. You can do all things through Christ. And here's a big one. You've been transferred into the kingdom of the Son. Jesus said those in the kingdom of God are greater than John the Baptist. And guess who John the Baptist was greater than? Luke 7:28, "For I say to you, among those born of women, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." So it could be argued you're actually greater than David.
So I'm David, and the Goliath is my debt, or it's my difficult marriage, or it's my boss at work.
We're going to keep our distance from our enemy and sling our stones until every Goliath falls down in our life.
I'm going to grab the stone of faith, and I'm going to sling it at my giant, at this boss at work, and I'm going to slay, and I'm going to hold up his head.
You're going to defeat that giant. Yes, that obstacle is big, but you have greatness in you.
And that would be a very narcissistic way to read the Bible.
Okay, so we already mentioned how common it is for Christians to use combative language to describe their disagreements. And again, anybody can do this with any doctrinal difference. I could say people who see themselves as having been sovereignly chosen by God for salvation, while others have been destined to hell, have a narcissistic way of reading the Bible. And you could say the opposite. People who read the Bible and see themselves as somehow wise enough and empowered enough to respond to the gospel are the narcissists. You could even say people who justify calling out false teachers by saying Paul did it, as if they're Paul. In the words of Chandler, "I love you enough to be straight, you're not Paul!" So as far as this kind of theatrical language, I hope you guys are beginning to understand how the game is played. As far as dealing with Chandler's actual remarks concerning inserting ourselves into Bible stories, while it's not something I would normally do, the Bible does say scriptures are used for instruction in righteousness. If people are gleaning instruction on how to act and live righteously through that kind of imagery, who has the authority to say that is an incorrect mode of instruction?
You know who conquers our giants? Christ conquers our giants. It's not me that conquers my giant. Like, the great giant of my life, sin and death, cannot be conquered by me picking up a stone of faith and throwing it, but by the finished work of Christ, who conquered death with a single shot.
But we're in Christ, and we see through Scripture that we were there. It says we were crucified with him. It says we were buried with him. We were raised with him. We were seated with him. So yeah, if you want to say this is symbolic for Christ overcoming death in the grave, I agree. But that wouldn't exclude our victory and our place in Christ from the story. The Bible says we're more than conquerors through him. The Bible says we have overcome the world. The Bible says we have overcome the wicked one. And yes, that's all because we are in Christ. I think part of the tension of this whole conversation is the feeling like it's got to be one or the other. Either you preach and believe X, or you preach and believe Y, the narcissistic way of reading the Bible or the Christ-centered hermeneutic. But who makes up the parameters of either of these? How do I know they're not both Christ-centered and you're not just being overly critical of how God is choosing to reveal his word to someone else? This is where a lot of claims get made in an attempt to draw a distinction, but the only trouble is most of them can't be observed in Scripture. The Bible says the wisdom of God is multifaceted. You may have latched onto one facet and someone else onto another, and it's changing your lives and it's producing fruit, and God is working in all of it. It's a beautiful thing. It's not something that we should be afraid of or discouraging. Having said all that, Brandon wanted to expound on this portion of the film in his email to us and say, quote, "The overall point of this section of the film is to show that the Bible is primarily about God and what he has done to save sinners in the person of Jesus Christ. This is contrasted against the narcissistic, man-centered reading of Scripture, where one only and primarily takes biblical characters as moral examples while ignoring Christ and the gospel." Thank you, Brandon, for clarifying, but I'm not sure any of the people featured in your clips here would disagree with you. I'd imagine that they would, like you do here, have additional ways of explaining themselves and clearing up any misunderstandings if you were to ask them. Now, Kimber says they did reach out to all these guys and were turned down for interviews and additional explanations. It's possible they passed because they didn't feel they would get a fair shake. I can't really blame them for that, given the constant onslaught of attacks they endure on a daily basis from not only social media, but the media in general. The other possibility is one that I unpack in our video, The One-Sided Debate of the Word of Faith Message, where I give my theory as to how this debate has come to look the way it does today. In situations where you can't get further explanation of what a person said, you could preface the quote or video clip with something like, "We're dealing with what they actually said, but it's important that we leave this open for them to further clarify." Or you could speculate about a reasonable explanation. Remember, audience doesn't decide the meaning. The speaker does. So if the speaker isn't present to clarify, all you really have is speculation about what thought they were attempting to convey. We're going to end here, but I do want to share this video that we posted a while back. It takes Stephen Furtick less than 2 minutes to explain himself concerning a misunderstanding Chandler had about something he had seen in a video clip of Furtick. Misunderstandings happen. Misspeaking happens. We need grace, we need patience, and we need to believe the best about one another. Thanks, guys.
So I come across this video of you, and granted, I know I don't want to be judged by things I've said 10 years ago or whatever, but of you rebuking your crowd for wanting depth, and your defense of that was that we've seen 1,000 people saved here. So from your own mouth, and the pulpit drives the church.
Yeah.
I mean, people can say whatever they want, but the pulpit drives the church. You're in front of your congregation saying, you know, you guys want to talk about reform, you guys want to talk about this doctrine, this doctrine. Well, I want you to know, we baptized 1,000 people. You can go somewhere else for that. And everybody cheers. And I'm heartbroken going, you just did it, bro. You literally just said evangelism and doctrine are exclusive.
Yeah.
And so that's the kind of thing for me that I look at that and I'm going, oh, Stephen.
You watched the whole sermon or the
No, that's what I'm saying. And that's what I'm saying. It's unfair because you judge by sound bites, right? Yeah. So that's what I saw.
Well, the whole sermon was online. You should watch the whole thing. It's pretty excellent. Because in that context, you're in Dallas, I'm in Charlotte. Our cities are very similar. We have a lot of people.
Church on every corner.
A form of godliness, deny the power thereof, dead dry religion, Ezekiel 37, valley of dry bones. We're dealing with a lot of that. And so to be, and you know this very well, sometimes I have to be hyperbolic. And I watched that clip too. And man, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that was, I remember it was actually the third service of the day and the tone was off and was very angry. However,
I like angry.
It does make me angry to think about how many people are cycling through my church as one out of four churches that they attend. You know, they go to this one because they like the children's ministry, this one because their friends go there, this one because the worship's hot. Yeah. And so sometimes, yes, There is a hyperbolic sense in which I will say, if all you want to do is go deeper, and what you mean by deeper is give me abstract theoretical truth that is so lofty and so disconnected that I don't have to do anything about it, just confuse the heck out of me so that I won't have to go home and treat my wife any better, or so that I won't have to step across the street and reach my neighbors. Yes, I'm going to exaggerate my point to say, get out of here if that's what you want. And that was the context of that clip in the sermon, but you don't see the rest of that in the 5-minute clip.